I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's sound portrait of an unlikely hero. The Heir Hunters. Starring Ken Berry. Joanne Worley. And Edgar Bergen. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Holiday Inns, Quaker State Motor Oil, and the Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Young Mr. Happy-Go-Lucky, frolicking his way through life in search of the missing heir to a fortune. He enlists the financial assistance of Clarence J. Walden, a professional heir hunter, in return for his services. The search leads Dean Quinn first to Seattle and a dead end, then to Chicago to an address listed in the old newspaper clipping, to the apartment house owned by Ignaz Pasek, and face-to-face with Pasek's young granddaughter, Stella. They meet again at Dean's hotel under an odd set of circumstances. Stella wants something. Out. Bus fare to California and a place to hide overnight. Dean wants no part of it, but he does want to find the missing heir. And what he finds is that now he's looking for one last link, the end of the family line, Helen Martin. He also finds himself half drowned in a swimming pool in Palm Springs with a dead body floating in the deep end. To put it in Dean Quinn's own words, why me? The Heir Hunters will continue after this word.
Am I drunk? I must be drunk. What happened here? Did I fall in and hit my head on the side of the pool, or did someone, whoever killed her, did they try to frame me? Come on, Dean boy, put it together or your ticket is forever punched. Chicago. Remember Chicago. Remember Stella? Stella was in my room at the Drake Hotel in Chicago when she told me about Charlie Martin.
Martin is dead. He got killed in Korea.
What about the little girl, Helen?
I don't know what happened to her. Can I have that drink now?
Yeah, help yourself.
Who are you calling?
Don't sweat, sweets. I'm not blowing the whistle on you.
This is the voice of Clarence J. Walden, president of Clarence J. Walden and Associates Insurance Representatives, where we pride ourselves in paying our claims promptly.
Boss, wait.
Our office is closed for the day, but we'll be back tomorrow morning when the big hand is on the 12 and the little one is at the 9.
Aren't you going to talk?
Yeah, if he ever shuts up.
If your call is urgent, please leave your name and number, and one of our representatives will get back to you as soon as possible. You will have exactly 10 seconds after you hear the little beep.
Boss, this is Dean. Charles Kermit Martin was killed in Korean War, Illinois Regiment. Call VA, check where allotment was sent for his daughter, Helen Martin. Also insurance. Call me at Drake Hotel. Wire money.
Sport, you sound like a disc jockey.
Hey, what are you doing? Put your clothes back on.
I'm getting into bed. I need my beauty rest.
Well, Yeah, I think I'll sack out on the couch here. Sweet dreams. I slept lousy that night. I kept waking up, hearing buzzing in my ears like I used to when pneumonia was coming on. A couple of times I thought I felt something warm cuddling up to me, but I couldn't tell for sure. Might have been just a vivid hallucination. In the morning, I had a brute of a headache. My skin was crawling, and I had a pretty good case of cotton mouth. Worst of all, I was in the bed. Stella was up and dressed. Stella, how did I get here? I mean, in the bed.
I don't know.
Did I get up and... I mean, we didn't...
You kept kicking around saying you were cold.
Well, I was. What time is it?
5 o'clock. I'm bored.
5 o'clock?
You're going to fall out of bed if you keep jumping around. Some guy called while you were sleeping. I wrote it down.
Walden called?
You don't have to yell. Lay down. He said the name you wanted was Mrs. Vivian Clay, Route 1, Towan, Illinois. He also said he wasn't underwriting no playing around with girls.
Oh, I'm going back to sleep. Maybe I'll get lucky and wake up dead.
Boy, you're no fun.
But I woke up alive the next morning. I just felt dead. I rented a car and Stella drove me to see Vivian Clay in Towan, a tiny town about 60 miles outside of Chicago.
Hey, Deanie, nice farm.
Is this the place?
Mailbox said so.
Then turn in. Vivian Clay was a gray-haired, pleasant woman with firm, regular features. She served us hot tea, which helped me listen as she explained that Helen Martin was her niece, whom she raised when her brother, Charlie Martin, died in Korea. She knew very little about Etta Rhine Martin other than that she was Helen's mother.
This here is a picture of Helen taking when she graduated high school.
Very pretty girl.
That's a pretty old picture.
Mrs. Clay, how old is Helen now?
Well, 26. Helen travels a lot. After high school, she went to Northwestern. We saved her dad's army insurance. And then she went to study art in that Paris of Rome. Later, she came back to New York and worked as one of them models.
Where is she now?
California.
Pardon? My head's a little clogged. Did you say California?
Yes, near Los Angeles.
Is there any place I can write her?
Why, yes. She has a post office box in that North Hollywood.
I don't remember leaving Vivian Clay or her farm, or driving back to Chicago or anything. I don't even know where or when I lost Stella Pasek. I was coughing and sneezing, dizzy, totally spaced out. I just wanted to get back to Beth. Somehow I did. Beth called a doctor, and he came and did his thing for 4 days. On the fifth day, my lungs breathed air again, and I sat up in Beth's king-size bed, ready for action.
How are you feeling?
Like 10,000 bucks. Girl, oh, am I glad to see you.
I'll get it. Yes?
What bungalow does Mr. Dean Quinn live in?
This one. Is he expecting you?
Oh, sort of. I'm a very good friend of his, and he asked me to visit.
Beth!
Well, why don't you come in? Any friend of Dean's is a friend of mine.
Oh, why me? Beth, this is Stella Pasek, an acquaintance. Stella, Beth Temple.
You don't look so good, Deanie.
I've been sick, and I think I'm getting a relapse.
Lucky I didn't catch your cold when you insisted I stay with you in that crummy hotel.
What crummy hotel?
Beth, please.
Do you have a place to stay, dear?
Not yet.
I have a nice little bungalow, number 9, only $80 a month. It would make it awfully convenient for Deanie. And you don't have any other friends here, and, well, we could be friends, couldn't we?
Oh, yes.
I feel sick.
Yeah. Let's get you settled. Stella, is it?
I can always tell when I'm not being appreciated, so I got up and left the El Cairo. I hitched over to Universal City to see Walden and to bring him up to date. He was delighted to see me.
Look at those expenses.
Well, it's nothing to get uptight about, Mr. Walden. We got an address for Helen Martin. Post office box, North Hollywood.
Post office won't give you her home address. They don't give out that information except to the FBI or the IRS. You aren't either of them.
I know that. I wrote her a letter and I mailed it to the box number. I just need a little more time until she picks it up.
All right, Quinn. You better find Helen Martin soon. I'm in business to find fortunes, not spend them.
That evening, when I got back to the bungalow, things had nearly returned to normal. Beth mixed up vodka martinis and brought out an old shoebox full of photographs. There were a lot of her as a small girl and some of her mother, Josie, who really was a fox, like she said. There was only one of her father, a man you couldn't pick out in a small crowd if you'd seen him 100 times. But in the hodgepodge of snapshots was a picture of Edgar Ryan. He was in a photo with 2 other men, all of them grinning like idiots into the camera. From their clothes, I guessed it was taken around 1925.
That one, with the sailor's jacket and derby.
He's Edgar Ryan?
That's him. Of course, when I saw him, he didn't look much like that.
Yeah, 50 years in between can change a man. Who are the 2 guys with him?
I don't know.
On the back, somebody wrote Ed, Hack, and Tony. Well, Ed's obviously Edgar Ryan. Have you any idea who Hack and Tony are?
Not the slightest.
Where'd the picture come from?
Dad's things. I don't know how it got there, and Dad's name wasn't Hack or Tony. It was William Temple.
Yeah. You ready for another drink?
Don't rush. We're having a guest for dinner. Who? Stella.
It seemed that the sweet, shy little country girl from the Mecca of the corn country had done right well for herself. Stella was now a cigarette girl at the Yodel A-Go-Go, a rock joint on the Sunset Strip. It was enough to make a man give up smoking.
Beth, hello.
Stella, darling.
Oh, hello, Dean. You here? Beth, isn't my job simply wonderful?
Just perfect. I'll get the drink so we can toast to your success.
Well, will it make me sicky? I never had a drink till I met Dean. Hope I can hold it.
I don't believe it.
Be back in a minute.
Dean, will you come over to my place later?
What do you hear from Chicago, kid?
You'll be sorry. Where are you going?
Just to the door for some air. I could have written a letter to dear Abby that would have given her a mental block. Anyway, a few days later, a tall, slender, beautiful blonde showed up at the post office and picked up my letter. I could tell it was the one I'd sent by the red envelope. She was driving away in a silver, chrome-plated monster as I arrived to start my daily stakeout. But I got her license number, which Walden could check out through the Department of Motor Vehicles. This new development encouraged him enough to write to Cook County, Illinois, for a copy of Helen Martin's birth certificate to prove she was the legitimate heir of Edgar Ryan. I also convinced him that it was worth a gamble for me to go to San Francisco and see what the Maritime Union's main office had on Edgar Ryan. Not enough of a gamble, however, to buy me plane fare. Beth was kind enough to allow me the use of her car. Good old girl, oh. At the Maritime Union, a nice old lady named Miss Morrissey told me she'd been working there ever since she got out of business college, which I figured was about the time somebody invented the typewriter. She went through a lot of dusty old cardboard files.
Aha! Here it is. Is this what you want?
Name, Edgar A. Ryan. Citizen, USA, born March 13th, 1897. Place of birth, Morro Bay, California. Married? No. I'm guessing he was divorced.
No, it would say if he was a divorced man.
Oh, there must be some mistake. I know for a fact that Edgar Ryan was a family man.
Who knows better, him or you?
So, with Miss Morrissey's information, the bottom fell out again. If old Edgar Ryan had never married, he couldn't have any direct heirs. Now, this had come up before, so I brushed it off and kept looking for Helen Martin. There had to be a connection. There were just too many unexplained coincidences otherwise. After I left the union office, I went over to the Daily Tribune. I placed a classified ad under personals. It read, Edgar A. Ryan, reward. Anyone having known him, write to Mr. Dean Quinn, care of Clarence J. Walden and Associates, Universal City, California. I drove like crazy to get back to L.A., but I had to lay over in Santa Maria, thanks to a bad cheeseburger. When I finally cruised Walden, he had all the poop on the silver monster I'd seen at the post office. It was registered to Florencia Monti, Acacia Drive, Brentwood. I didn't waste any time getting there. A butler, sporting a bit of a belly and a broken nose, informed me that no Helen Martin was there, ever had been, or was ever expected to be. But after some diplomatic negotiation on my part, he agreed to escort me to see Miss Monty, who did indeed live there, and at that point in time was sunning herself out by the swimming pool. It was the same blonde, all right. She was stretched out on the diving board, wearing a sliver of a bikini, tanning herself, head cradled in her arms. I couldn't see her face. Without moving her head, she said,
What do you want?
Are you Helen Martin?
No.
You are Florencia Monti?
Via, please.
You know Helen Martin?
Yes. I know her, but I don't like to feel responsible for her. I keep a post office box in the valley for my own personal use. With a house full of servants, one has very little privacy.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Every letter that comes, all my own special little secrets. Anyway, I gave Helen permission to use my post office box.
Don't you forward her mail?
Yes, certainly, whenever she writes to tell me where she is. I haven't heard from her in over a year.
Last time, where from?
Hong Kong, I think, or some such place. She travels, buys, imports clothes.
How long have you known Helen Martin?
Oh, years. 6, perhaps, or 7. I met her when she was studying in Paris. My family keeps a place there, although they live in Rome.
And you met again here in California?
Something like that. We've kept in touch.
Do you have Helen's last forwarding address?
Someplace around. I'll have to look for it. If I find it, I'll let you know.
Yeah, do that. I'll leave my card. I'll write down another number where I can be reached.
Oh, you are an insurance man. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Claims paid promptly. It says right there. I hope I'll be hearing from you, Miss Monty.
Zia.
See you, Zia. After meeting with Florencia Monty, I paid a visit to the bank where Walden did his business. I asked Tilford Jones, one of the vice presidents, to give me a Dun & Bradstreet report on Florencia Monty. He told me that she was AAA1, top credit rating, which came as no surprise after I'd peeped her palace. Jones also gave me the lowdown on her personal background when I asked for it. Zia Monty was a legal representative with power of attorney for Roma Fiducia, an Italian holding company under a Swiss charter. Jones explained that the company was primarily an investment house and did very little trading in stocks and bonds, all of which meant nothing to me. Zia was working here under the supervision of her home office, and she was very likely a blood relative of one of the company's high executives. A lot of the old European firms still did business in the old-fashioned way, keeping it in the family. I thanked Jones for the information, and while I still had use of Beth's car, drove back to Universal City to see if Walden had anything further for me.
So what's the skinny on the Mounty woman?
Well, she's above board, boss, but she's not Helen Martin.
Didn't expect she would be.
Don't worry, Mr. Walden. Something has to break soon. I think Helen Martin is in China.
China? Why don't you take a break, Quinn? Go home. Go back to law school.
Oh, Rome wasn't built in a day, you know.
What's that got to do with Helen Martin?
Well, I don't know. She studied there.
Quinn, you're a nice kid. I like you. Now, let's leave it at that. Oh, by the way, a letter came for you. And in the future, you won't use this address.
It's from San Francisco. Dear sir, read your ad in the San Francisco Tribune regarding Edgar Rhine. Used to know a man by that name once. Don't know if he's the same one you mean. Note your address is Los Angeles. My ship will make San Pedro on the 19th and sail early the morning of the 20th. You can look me up while I am there. Yours truly, Albert Kress, Second Officer, S.S. McAllister. The 19th? Well, that's today. Finally, your dumbness will kill you if you're not careful, because you'll go charging off one last time into someone with a cannon in his fist who's waiting just for you. Had I but known.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Heir Hunters. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Dean Quinn has been trying to locate Helen Martin, missing heiress to a hidden fortune. He's been fishing for clues, but to this point has caught only a good case of pneumonia. He meets Virginia Clay, Helen Martin's aunt, who sends him back to California into a post office box. Dean Quinn, back in California, back to his girl, Beth Temple, and into the fire, brought upon by the arrival of the irrepressible Stella Pasek from Chicago. But it's the business of heir hunting that Dean Quinn has chosen, so he follows the trail north to San Francisco, then back to Los Angeles, to the mansion of the young and beautiful, mysterious Florenzia Monti, but still not a trace of Helen Martin. He has no idea where or even who she is. Nor, for that matter, does he know exactly how he got to where he is, in a swimming pool, half-drowned and bleeding, and not alone. His company is dead, murdered. Dean Quinn wants to know, in a word, why. The Heir Hunters resumes after this message.
I pulled myself out of the pool and staggered into the living room. It was a mess. A disaster area. It looked worse than my head felt. Whoever had bopped me and killed her. Come on, Boyle. Remember it all or they'll get you for sure. Water. The harbor. Water. What am I thinking of? The McAllister. I went to the pier to talk to Albert Kress about Edgar Rhine.
Sure, I knew Edgar Rhine. Often wondered what happened to him. Last saw him maybe 15 years ago. He was second engineer aboard the Sulu Seas, a tanker older than Noah's Ark. I was on her, too, as an A.B. Hey, more coffee?
No thanks, Mr. Kress.
Well, we picked up a cargo of crude in the Persian Gulf, sailed up to the Red Sea, to the Med, stayed over in Istanbul a couple of days and sailed back to the States. We got held up at customs when we berthed in Jersey. Ship was swarming with treasury men. They'd been tipped off that we'd picked up some junk in Turkey. Point I'm making, Ryan left a ship there in Jersey. Well, what was odd was he'd signed on from the West Coast.
You mean he deserted?
No, he just drew his pay and walked off. Didn't say goodbye or go to hell.
I drove back to face Walden again. I thought maybe what Kress had told me might perk him up a little.
So what?
Well, I don't think old Ryan was in on the smuggling from the start, but he knew that engine room and everything in it. He found where the stuff was hidden, quit the ship, and walked off with a couple of tobacco tins of pure morphine.
I won't condone that. $100,000 from dope, salted away in little bank accounts under different names. The government will attach those accounts when they're revealed in probate.
No, they won't. They'd only be guessing. There's absolutely no proof. Besides, there's the statute of limitations.
I'm not going to argue with you, Quinn. You got me into this, but I'm getting out now.
You can't. We've got a contract for a year.
Oh, have we? There's your contract. Want to sue me?
So I was canned. On my way out of Walden's office, I asked Nora, his secretary, to refer any telephone calls for me to El Cairo Court. Flat broke again and really down. I went back to Bets.
Hello, honey. Stella and I have been out shopping. Well, how'd it go at the office today?
Oh, great, if you dig getting fired.
Oh, Dean. Well, what are you going to do?
I don't know. I guess I could go back to passing out handbills.
Hey, maybe I could fix you up with a job. One of the boys at the club quit last night.
A job doing what?
Parking cars.
How much? You know, I've been making pretty good bread.
You'll do it.
So I took it. That night, Beth drove Stella and me to work at the Yodel A-Go-Go. It had no parking lot of its own. Steep hills above and steep hills below. I could tell right off it was going to be tough sledding. Stella introduced me to a young dude in a red T-shirt and tight white stretch pants.
Kilroy, this here's my very own first cousin, Dean.
Stella, I don't think that's...
He needs a job real bad, and right away I thought of you, Kilroy.
Really? You thought about me?
Yeah, he's an awful good driver, and I think you were just so sweet. You know what I mean?
How could Kilroy say no? He couldn't say anything at all with his eyes popping out, watching Stella slink into the club. Then the suckers began arriving, and we, the real suckers, started parking cars. We stashed them all up and down the side streets on both sides of Sunset, anywhere within 5 blocks. Then we had to whip back to the club on a dead run for the next one. By the time the club closed, I was a basket case. This wasn't a job for someone with chronic pneumonia. Back in El Cairo, I found Beth asleep on the couch. She left me a note explaining why. Dear Chaser, a girl named Nora called to leave a message for you that another girl named Zia wants you to call her in the morning. I think you should know that this is not an answering service and you might think about looking for new pastures to graze in. Let sleeping giants lie. Beth. I met Zia for lunch at the Barrier Reef, a little restaurant on the beach near Malibu. Seems she was interested in buying a paid-up insurance annuity.
Could you sell me one?
Sure, I guess so. How large an annuity?
Oh, $250,000.
$250,000?
I want one that will pay me, say, $10,000 a year for the rest of my life.
Yes. Sure, of course. Well, I'll work out the details. I didn't tell Zia I wasn't working for Walden any longer because, knowing Walden, I knew he wouldn't turn down the kind of business I had in my pocket. My commission would be somewhere around $7,500, exclusive of what Walden made for overriding it. I swaggered into his office, and we drew up another contract. 3 days later, I called Zia at home.
I must talk to you about the project again.
What? You haven't changed your mind?
I don't want to discuss it over the phone. If you could meet me this afternoon, why not drive with me to Palm Springs? We can talk on the way.
Boy, oh, this is the way to do business. I've never been out this way before.
About that annuity, Dean. I want it in the name of Constance Niles.
I thought it was for you.
Of course it's for me. I simply want it in another name. Is it so wicked to want to save taxes?
No, but I doubt the insurance company will issue to a false name. And Internal Revenue has laws, too.
All right. But I think I can convince you. If not, perhaps I'll have to cancel the policy.
Just checking out the way Zia was built, I didn't need much coaxing. The hideaway was several miles outside of Palm Springs, a sprawling desert adobe the same color as the sand surrounding it. The place was closed up. No servants were there or anybody. The small cottage, as she called it, was actually a vast ranch house, complete with air conditioning. Zia opened a bottle of champagne and another of brandy and mixed French 75s. We sat on the patio beside the swimming pool, watching the mysterious blue desert night come down. The moon was a huge incandescent globe that pulverized the heavens with powdered light. The whole scene was totally surreal. I couldn't believe what was happening. Boy, oh, she was really some tomato. By the time we left Palm Springs for Los Angeles the next day, Zia had me convinced. Convinced that if I didn't change the name on the annuity to Constance Niles, I'd lose the sale and never see her again. And I didn't intend to do either. Hi, I'm back.
And just in time. Kilroy says you're fired if you don't show up tonight. And after all the humiliation I had to go through to get you the job.
I know, dear.
Hey, since when have you ladies decided to run my life for me? From now on, I am running my own. I'll pack my stuff and get out.
Where are you going? The Century Plaza? And how much money you got?
He doesn't have $10.
And he'll spend that out chasing girls. It's a good thing he's got you, Beth, to keep an eye on him.
Dean, why don't you move back into number 9? Stella can move in with me.
Oh, please. Knock it off. So I moved into number 9, and Stella started camping with Beth. Until my insurance commission came through, I still needed the tips from the parking lot. There was a lousy band playing that night, and business was slow, so I didn't make much money, but at least I kept most of my sweat inside my body. Stella got a ride from that same guy as last time, but in a different car. A shiny, new domestic model, about a half a block long, and Kilroy was plenty teed off.
Hey, Dean, looky here. I guess I fixed that creep. Took it right out of his glove compartment.
Kilroy, that's a gun.
Yeah, real pretty, ain't it? Yaffe Kush don't go into those cheap stuff.
Yaffe Kush?
Yeah, the jerk driving Stella home big time, big shot, syndicate. This has got to be worth at least $50.
Are you out of your mind? You stole a gun from him? He'll come back looking for it.
Nah, he's got plenty more. Hey, Dean, be on time tomorrow now, will you?
Hey, Kilroy, look at that broad.
Where?
Over there, across the street.
I don't see no broad.
Oh, you missed her. She's gone now. Hmm. Well, see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
I couldn't let Kilroy keep that gun. He was an all right guy, and I didn't want to see him getting snuffed for something so dumb. So while he was looking across the street, I lifted the gun from his saddlebag. After he was gone, I put it in a paper bag, and I hid it in the bushes by the club. Let's see, that was Friday night. I called in sick on Saturday, and Sunday the clubs closed. I was in Bungalow 9 about 10:30 Sunday night, washing out my drip-dry shirt when... Yeah.
Hi, sport.
Stella? Out. Out!
Gee, it's nice to be alone at last. Beth's gone to a movie.
Stella, go back to Beth's place. You know what she'd think if she found you here.
Oh, boy, I wouldn't want to hurt Beth. We're dear friends. But you did break up with her, didn't you?
Do you have anything cooking on the stove?
No. Why?
Well, in that case, Beth's bungalow is on fire. I guess it was the most excitement they'd had in the neighborhood for some time. All those sirens and flashing red lights brought people together who hadn't seen each other in years. Actually, the fire wasn't that bad. The cops seemed to think the blaze was a cover-up for something else. Maybe robbery. They noted that the furniture was smashed and the drawers emptied out. As far as Stella and I could see, nothing was missing, so they wrote it up as a stock case of teenage vandalism. After they'd gone, does Yaffe Kush know you live here?
Of course not.
Then how have you been getting home? On a magic carpet?
For your information, Mr. Kush is a gentleman, which is more than I can say for you. He calls me a cab whenever I want to come home.
It never occurred to you he might own the cab company?
Mr. Kush is in the machine business, Mr. Smarty.
Sure he is. Slot machines, vending machines, political machines.
Oh, I hate you.
Oh, hate me later. Help me clean up this mess before Beth gets home. I didn't come right out and say to Stella that I thought Yaffe Cush had been there looking for his missing gun and tried to burn the place down when he couldn't find it. The next day, I went to see Walden about any late developments in the Florenzia Monte Constance Niles deal.
Ah, Quinn, yeah, come in.
Back to the old drawing board, I see.
I just can't seem to give it up or beat the damn thing.
You ever consider cheating?
There's a letter for you. It's from Chicago.
It's a photostat of Etta Rhine's and Charlie Martin's marriage license.
Still plugging away, eh, Quinn?
Another bummer. Etta Rhine's father was Henry Rhine. So if, and I don't even know if I can find out, if Henry Rhine and Edgar Rhine were brothers, that would make Helen Martin, wherever she is, Edgar's grandniece, not his granddaughter.
So what? We're off the Rhine case anyway.
Yeah. Well, there's still my insurance commission.
Hello?
Zia, it's Mia. Clean Dean. It's all set.
Wonderful. I'll be out by Palm Springs tomorrow. What do you say we meet at the hideaway? 8 o'clock? We'll have a private little party in honor of the event.
Boy, oh, that sounds terrific. I'll bring the papers.
I'll bring the money. $250,000 in cash.
Cash? What's wrong with a cashier's check?
It'll be safe. I'll keep it under lock and key in my cosmetics box in the trunk of the car. Besides, a cashier's check would involve a bank, and I don't see where it's any of their business, do you?
Well, no, I guess you're right. See you at 8.
Bye now.
The next morning, I rented a car and drove all over town to make sure everything was in perfect running condition. At 6 o'clock, I couldn't sit any longer. I made sure I had the papers, and... Oh, no. No, why now? Why me?
Want me to start?
No.
Well, what are you going to do?
I don't know. I can't kill myself without fumes.
You can use my car. I won't need it tonight.
Oh, girl, oh, you'd do that for me? I was almost to the freeway when I thought of something. Bringing all that cash back with me could be dangerous. So I turned up Wilcox and headed toward Sunset in the Strip. Kilroy wasn't there yet, so nobody recognized me when I went looking in the bushes. I found the paper bag with Yaffe's gun, then headed out for Palm Springs. A bit late, but on my way. I thought I could make up some lost time out in the open road, but I made a wrong turn and I was halfway to Indio before a gas station attendant straightened me out. It was almost 9:30 when I made the turn onto the long dirt road. I threaded my set of wheels into the 5-car garage attached to the house. The garage was empty except for the stodgy, square, conservative coupe she had driven down in. I parked beside it and got out. As I walked past the car, I remembered the cosmetics case locked in the trunk. Pretty baby. $250,000. I'll take real good care of you. Hello? Zia, it's Mia! I walked from the garage around the house to the main entrance. The wind was up. I dodged a tumbleweed that blew across the lawn. The desert cools off fast at night. I hoped it hadn't cooled her off towards me. The lights were on in the living room, so she was here like she'd promised. I punched the doorbell. I stood there quite a while, but no one answered. I was getting impatient, both for Zia and my commission. 33% of nothing is nothing. I knocked on the door, just one little rap, and it swung open. Anyone here? At ease, dry your tears.
Dean's here. Hello, anyone home?
The living room was empty. Also the dining room, the library, sunrooms, kitchen, and the game room. The whole joint was deserted. I opened the sliding glass door and stepped outside to the patio and pool. The outdoor lights were off, and it was plenty dark. Almost concealed in the darkness by the side of the pool nearest to me, something was bobbing in the water. I stepped to the edge of the pool to take a better look. Oh. Oh, boy, oh. Zia stared up at me from the water. Her eyes and her mouth were wide open, and her hair was matted to the side of her head. Except for the features of her face and the curled fingers of one outstretched hand, her body was suspended a few inches beneath the surface. I didn't have a chance to see any more because, without warning, my arms were pinned behind me and some ape had his hands around my throat. There were two of them, but I couldn't see who they were. Then I got zapped upside my head. Oh! Like I told you, if you're not careful, you can get killed.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Air Hunters. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Metropolitan Life Insurance, Delco Batteries, and Bear Aspirin. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.